channel cable.
Yay.
Nice and easy. So hello everyone. My name is Quintessence and I'm a developer advocate for Walk My Own, which is a company that's actually based in Tel Aviv. And provides health as a service. And today I'm going to be talking to you about my favorite topics, monitoring. And the goal of sensory-friendly monitoring is to really start to kind of figure out how we can make a monitoring system that is not only comprehensive, but still, you know, doesn't overwhelm you with the noise and all of the alerting and the chaos where you're getting notified from everything in Jira to lunch to status page and everything else that you have all hooked up together. And, you know, we kind of fall into this own trap on our own because we want to know everything. We want to know what's going on, and before we know it, we have no way to actually digest all of this information, and what ends up happening is we start muting alarms, and then they are no longer helpful because we're not receiving them, and then when there's actually a legitimate problem that we needed to know about, we don't know about it. So then we turn the dial down, and we wonder why nothing's going off. So it's this search for finding a nice happy balance between getting the information you need and not nothing. One of the ways to get started in analyzing this problem is to know your space. What does your infrastructure look like? What integrations could you potentially have? Do you want to hook AWS into Slack and email and PagerDuty? Do you want to connect GitHub into email and Slack? And all of these iterations, you know, do you want to get a notification every time someone writes a Confluence page or every time someone updates a Jira ticket or a ServiceNow ticket or what have you? In order to declutter, you can start by asking yourself, what do I need to know? And it's more about need than wants. You might want to know, or you might find it passingly interesting that someone wrote a blog post for your company. You might not want to get an alert on your phone and your computer and your Apple Watch to that fact, right? So you kind of want to know, do I need to know this, or does somebody need to know this? And you want to know who that somebody is, because if I'm a developer working on the core app and the load balancer goes down, that's just misappropriated information. It doesn't help anybody. I can't do anything about it, and then I have to track down the infrastructure. I also need to know how soon I need to know, because if I don't need a 2 a.m. phone call, I do not want a 2 a.m. phone call about whatever's going on. And more to that point, maybe I shouldn't be getting a phone call at all ever. Maybe it's just a low-level, low-urgency alert that can go into my email or my Slack or some other, you know, auditing system that makes more sense. When you're asking yourself these questions, it's important to focus on what is actually useful. Because if you're not careful, you can make oversensitive alerts that are just trigger-happy. An example of this might be if you alert on the cause rather than a symptom. So, you know, you can alert on your web page being, you know, not responsive, having a high latency, or you can alert on having, you know, high RDS memory usage. High RDS memory usage, and for your database that's hooked up, if you're using AWS, you may or may not cause any real live problems for your customer base. So you're going to get an alert and you're going to ignore it because no one's reporting a problem in your ecosystem. And that leads to the ignored alerts. Similarly, you can have false negatives where you make an alert that doesn't trigger when it should. Where you say, oh, this is all fine, but maybe you're not catching a use case where maybe it's not. You've just made it way too permissive. If you have a system that's fragile, it's going to be triggering everything all the time and you're going to ignore things. Similarly, when it's triggering all the time, frequency, and if it's just fixable, make sure it gets tracked to be fixed. If you keep seeing the same alert because, oh, that thing's just flaky, you're going to start ignoring it eventually, and it's going to be a problem. You know, that high disk usage alert at 80% disk, you ignore it all the way up to 99, because I don't need to do it yet, and then it's dead. One way to keep things clean is to do incident management and clean up your alerts as they happen and just kind of triage them after the fact. So if something's triggering and you can resolve it, did you or some manual person need to resolve it? Is your solution permanent? Did you automate it away? If you automated it away, can you delete the alert so it doesn't continue to fire? And these types of things can be done so that you can keep an alert system that only pings you when it needs to be. That said, this isn't saying that you need to get rid of audit trailing, where you have things in logging. You know, there's a difference, you know, between having something pinging you and sending you notifications and having something that you can scoop up the data later. You might want to know when someone's logging into AWS or Azure. You don't need an alert about it, but if you need to go back in time and do some debugging, you definitely want it in your logs. I feel like I breeze right through that. So that's about an introduction to cleaning up your monitoring. Thank you for listening. And let me know if you have any questions after the lightning series.
We can take time for questions. Now, it's not the traditional way lightning talks are done. Traditionally, you do questions after, but while our speaker's still up there, we can take time if anybody has any questions.
So, I've got a quick one. I've always thought about this space, this problem, as is it actionable? Like, you know, if you're telling me something or if I'm measuring something and there's no action I can realistically take, then why am I getting that notification? So how do you think about the whole, there are certain things that I want to know about. Like, it might be handy to know about it, but I don't want to actually have it be like right up there on the big board. How do you kind of distinguish those two?
So I start by kind of keeping track in my own mind about the urgency and severity, and like you said, the actionability of the alert. You know, if there's an outage, I or someone on the production team needs to know and needs to triage and resolve it. Whereas if it's something that it's a good to know, like maybe I want to know, for instance, doing advocacy, I need to know when things are happening on our block. I need to know that. I do not need it to appear on my phone. I do not need it to clutter up a Slack channel. Maybe getting an email digest, you know, that type of alerting type of mechanism where it's still technically a type of alert, but it's a very low urgency. And
the frequency is lower.
And the frequency is lower, and I can just get a summary at the end of the day. And when you're setting up alerts, you know, maybe in AWS you have things in CloudWatch, and with Azure you have things that are just not a priority, and you just deprioritize the way you push them through SMS or for whatever you end up using, so that it's not, you know, loud, and you just use email or something that you're not necessarily hooked into like you would with your Slack.
Do you pipe your alerts to something for, like, looking for trends?
Actually, it's a nice question to ask. So one of the things that Logs.io, my current employer, offers is when you pipe your ELK, basically it's post-Elasticsearch, and they actually have what's called Cognitive Insights, which is a feature that you can use to triage frequency and severity of alerts, and it's basically doing an analysis on all of the logs you ship and giving you what it thinks are higher priority than the other based on content and source and some other algorithmic magic. So yes, you can prioritize things even coming from the same source or something like that and actually have them piped through different mechanisms to send out to people based on something like that, which you can have something similar maybe depending on what you have set up for your alerting system or who you're using.
Thank you very much, Gwen. All right, Matt.
So what I wanted to talk about today was programming languages and when to create your own. So my name is Matt Stock. My day job is with Limelight Networks, and we do a lot of, you know, content delivery stuff. We're a content delivery provider, global. And this is a little bit of a side project that I had. We have lots of systems and lots of things that need to be provisioned, and they all take different methods. There's a lot of different processes that have to be followed. And what I wanted to do is I said, you know, we really should be able to have some way to describe behaviorally what we want to do, and then have a system go and figure out the specific mechanisms to actually go out and do those things. And it be able to be smart and say, oh, this particular thing is an option on a, say, a command line, and this other thing needs to actually execute this code block, right? And so that took me down a little bit of a rabbit hole that I thought I'd share with you. So what I ended up doing is concluding that I really needed to write my own programming language, essentially. And this is, it's a little bit redacted, but this is the basic kind of configuration block. And I'm not gonna go through every single piece, but I'll just highlight some of the things that I think were interesting. So obviously this is XML based, but that's really just the, you know, the container format, right? So I don't have to build a parser, I'm using XML to do the things. I've got this short name block, and then inside it I have this phost block. I have two phost blocks, and then each one of those is path, and then finally there's some stuff inside path. Now what's interesting about this, and that might not be completely obvious looking at this, is that I defined actually a scope for each one of those things. So I can define stuff at the short name scope, like this behavior here, and it will be inherited as it goes through, just like a normal programming language. What the idea here is that I can actually go and describe these different behaviors, and then when I do this expand, it will actually go and turn it into a configuration output based on the different settings that I have at the different scopes, right? So very, very high level, but I'm gonna run it so that you can kind of see what it looks like. And so you can see here, maybe you can't, I don't know, can anybody read this? Squinting really hard. But basically you can see there's this two lines there of output. It's got an input and output and some different options that are set. And those are basically the same things. I'm going to try to put these side by side so you can kind of see it. But these are very similar. You know, the short name is the whole thing. And then each of these two phosts, one is each line. And then this one describes the elements on that first one, and the second one is that second block. Now, that by itself is really, really boring. You think, okay, well, you're just doing some syntactic rearrangement, which is true. You know, that's the obvious first step. But what's interesting, and this is the part that got me more interested in where I'm actually willing to call this a programming language, is that these tags, these element tags, are actually able to be implemented completely in XML itself. So I actually have here the definitions of those different things. And in this case, many of them are simple string substitutions. So when it sees the element behavior A, it's going to take fancy and whatever value was in that element and block it in. You can see this is, you know, I've got Python substitutions in here, but, you know. But it gets more exciting. This one right here, this behavior, is called origin, and you can see I actually implemented a variable setting operation inside the scope that this builds, and then I have conditional logic here. So what I'm able to do is I'm actually able to evaluate the elements that are sub-elements of this, or other points in the tree. It's actually relatively flexible. And then make decisions on whether or not I add or remove certain things. And then that is actually stored in the state, and then when I set that expand, well, this is a template that actually defines how that's actually done. So in this case, here's a stanza, just a template that it uses. And again, if the schema is HTTP, schema on the other line, then it'll use this one. Otherwise, it skips that, and it'll use this one down here if it's HTTPS. So you can do all of this stuff, and if I wanted to add new capabilities, as long as I could do it with variable setting and conditional, so I've only implemented if and set, I can do it by actually just building more complex versions inside the XML. I don't have to touch real code at all. The other thing that I want to mention is that because I can leverage the XML parser, all of the logic that I'm talking about here is 300 lines of Python. I mean, it's super, it was surprisingly simple. And you know, if I need to, say, make a loop, that will require a little bit more Python code to implement those behaviors, but not very much. I mean, it's actually, a lot of it is embedded in the design itself. So I thought it was really cool, and it's an example of how you can actually do some pretty powerful things if you want to, like, augment some sort of system that you're using with something that's a little bit more rigorous than a JSON data dump as an input source. You can actually do it, and it doesn't have to take a lot of work. The only thing I'll end with this is that I spent an enormous amount of time thinking about the way I wanted the structure of the code to work, and the key were the classes. I've created a class for the template, I created a class for the behaviors, and I created a class for my scope object. So every time I moved scopes, I created a new scope object, chained it to the parent, and it basically had the ability to say, well, if I'm looking for something, it knows, oh, it has a parent object, so it's going to search there if it can't find it, and it will continue to recurse. When I pop, that goes away, and so all of my scope handling was taken care of for me, almost for free. So anyway, that's it. If you enjoy programming languages, I encourage you to make one. They're fun. Thank you. Any questions? No?
What's a use case for this?
So the kind of standard use case is game developers do this kind of thing all the time for people to add their own user-generated content to the game. So it allows somebody who is not part of your core dev team to enhance and extend the capabilities, and you can give them a sandbox. So for me, my goal is kind of twofold. One is this piece right here, this I would only give to our internal team, creating new verbs, if you will, right? But that other configuration file, which is a description for a specific customer, I could give this to a customer, and they could do all the hard work of actually writing down their requirements in a form that I can validate, because it's in XML, I can actually validate it against a DTD if I want to, or probably something a little more sophisticated, but I could do that. And it's very clear and concise. There's no hand-waving involved, because it either fits or it doesn't. So that's probably the most powerful use case, is it allows you to delegate certain capabilities to maybe not full-throated developers and work in partnership. But it also means that, you know, you can, you don't have to have people touch the core of your code if they want to make enhancements, as long as you've given them some basic, you know, logic to work with. They can do a lot of interesting things. Okay. Thanks.
Thank you. All right, Mike.
Wish me luck.
Good luck.
You try to keep it in there?
Yep.
Okay. Well, we can find you a stand-in.
So what I'm showing off today is something that anybody in the room could do on their own, is set up your own personal cloud. So Nextcloud is an open source software that it's not too hard to read the install guides, and there's so many different ways to do it. All I'm going to do is show off some of the features and think maybe some people are going to do it for themselves. But so this is running on a server in my basement, because where else would you put your own servers, right? So it wasn't too hard to do for me, because I've been toying around with Linux for decades. But some people, what they do for their Nextcloud servers is they do that click-click stuff with the Amazon services, spin up a, and then, you know, there's a easy Nextcloud click and boom, you got your own thing running. So at first what I thought I was going to be getting into with Nextcloud was a place to store files. And that, you know, that's a given. And like any other spot, you've got all kinds of space to store things. Most of the documents that I've got in here were in my Google Drive, which I was running out of space anyways. Some of them came from other machines around the house. There's, you know, you just drag and drop files into your own cloud like any other cloud would work. So I got some family videos that are in a shared folder. These are, you know, from, I guess, when my wife was, before she was born, and her family from New York City. So those are, instead of sitting on YouTube, those are sitting in my site, my own personal cloud, which I can share a number of different ways. So I could share with somebody that's already got a login on my cloud through a federated one, where it would be like their username at their cloud URL, or through this link thing, which it was very impressive to me. Some of these features are because I clicked add this module or whatever, but you've got allow editing, you can password protect your shared link, and you can set an expiration date so that if the person doesn't look at it within a certain time period, boom, the link's done. In the administration section, you can block reshare, so that you're only sharing it to the person you shared it to, and not after that. I don't know how that works, because I'm not that good, but you can create your own checksums for your files, so monitor activities. So the files thing works a lot like what anybody else would expect. I found a thing called Rain Loop that I do my email with now on it. And the fancy thing about this is I get at any one of my accounts that I want to at any moment, which is, you know, sweet. I've tried a bunch of different things. I'm not gonna log into that, but so I tried a bunch of different things for managing multiple accounts, and all of them, like, they got ups and downs to them. Like MailSpring is my second favorite, but even MailSpring's got some, like, you only get this many before you have to pay them. So there's that. The you got an integrated calendar, which I don't have a good way to show you on the mobile device, but my mobile device is syncing to all these calendars. So when I change something on the mobile device, an appointment, a location that the appointment's gonna be at or whatever, it adjusts itself and puts it on here. And I set mine for like 4 hours on the phone, so I'm not like spending all kinds of time with that. But your calendar, this is a built-in feature of the Nextcloud. You've got your standard window and then your accessive things for every event. So you can add attendees to the event, reminders, set repeats, you got details, et cetera, et cetera. There's time zones and so forth. So there's a built-in calendar, there's a built-in file system, there's a built-in contacts, which also I'm syncing to my mobile devices. And this is really nice. I like the calendars and the contacts, I imported all my stuff. Like I did that Google takeout and I dumped my contacts list up and then I imported them here and gave them better categories. These categories come through on my phone. So in some ways it's got more features than your ordinary contact setup, but basically it's doing what all the other things do, except for the only one that knows your contacts is your own server now. Okay, another thing that bugged me is every time we tried to do FaceTime or a Google Hangout or whatever with anybody, it's always like choppy and throttled. And now that we all know about net neutrality being over and the big Wi-Fi companies seeing traffic go through Google Hangouts or whatever and they're throttling you, I thought, hey, wouldn't it be handy to have our own family cloud? So you've got a video communicator where you can talk to people on your own cloud, obviously, but you can also make new public calls. So you've got sharing of the link where you text a message to somebody and then after they get the message, they join in and they're in this group call. The built-in system for this is Spreed, S-P-R-E-E-D. I guess that was a technology that they got involved with early on in the Nextcloud, but you get up to 15 simultaneous people in your teleconference. So that's a really cool feature. And because it's only your URL, no big telecom company wants to throttle you yet. So you get really good service. Like the tests I've done on it, there's about a half second or less latency between the time that you say something and the other person hears it. So it's pretty impressive. And I am not on, a fast network or anything. So there's that's going on. There's tasks, which are kind of cool. Those are also syncing onto my phone. What I saw about their tasks that I didn't see with other ones is these sub things. And each one of these, you can set, start date, due date, priority, percent complete, et cetera, et cetera. All these things inside the cloud are shareable. Gallery is just a spin on files. Basically, the difference between files and gallery is the way that the listing is doing, whether you're in thumbnails or in list view. But the photos, let's see. Photos have a nice built-in little displayer like any other service would have through some cloud, so those features are there. Phone track, I really would like to show you that one, but as I was goofing around with it, the bandwidth ain't there. I have so much data already in mine that I can't get it to work right. But like Google has location tracking if you want to turn it on and it knows where you are. And I've got an app that sends information into Logger. So the phone track is by far the best of all these GPS things. But with the bandwidth here, I can't show off how cool it is. And that's every log file I've ever put in it so far. I didn't want to do that. Deselect all. I might have just deleted all my logs. They're on my phone anyways. But so you got your mail, you got your gallery, you got your tracking things, you got a built-in audio player. And I don't want to click on a song because I don't know if you like my music or whether you hear it right or not. But beyond that, there's also a radio finder, which I thought was pretty cool. So I can play different stations throughout the world through my own cloud. Let's see. DAC, this was an additional one. DAC is some sort of like a Kanban management system where you've got cards. I don't understand Kanban, so I'm not going to talk much about that. The people at Nextcloud are pretty responsive too. Like I tweeted them because I saw other management systems that use the Gantt chart type management, and they're already talking to each other. Those two software developers are talking about integration already. All they did was tweet the two of them, hey, how about this? So the GPS, the phone track people have already added an idea I gave them on Git. So this is a pretty cool thing going on. Flow upload is, if you're in a hurry, it's a add-on that lets you dump folders in a way that it's quicker than, you know, grabbing a bunch of files and putting them into a specific folder on your cloud. Let's see. Announcements, that's something that it's a mini interaction thing, and right now my admin, me, there's no announcements on for anybody, but like you as an admin can make these announcements and you show up on everybody's login. You get your activity circles, not sure about that. Phone sync, this is a text message thing where you can, like the app on your phone sends all your text messages up to your cloud. You throw away your phone, you get a new phone, and you sync from your cloud, and boom, all your text messages are now on your new phone. So it's not that big of a deal, but it's pretty cool. Switching over to the managerial side. So you as a manager of the system, there's so much cool control to it. Which apps are available, how they're displayed. I don't know, I feel like I'm rattling on. I can just stop now. There's also an app store where you've got a bunch of default app bundles, because these guys have been doing it for a while. It used to be called OwnCloud, but you've got enterprise app bundles where, you know, one click and all of a sudden you've got all these apps. My servers, I got all secure servers, but they've got something beyond that. Where is it? I thought it was an enterprise bundle. Maybe I missed it with my eyes. There's a end-to-end encryption thing somewhere, which I haven't turned on yet, but this is like a new, real popular thing for businesses. The end-to-end encryption is where you set up your phone with your giant secret passcode, and it encrypts the file before it leaves your phone, goes to your cloud encrypted, so that like if you were gonna use somebody else's public cloud, you could even have it encrypted where the admin, like me, can't see your stuff. So they built the end-to-end encryption into Nextcloud, but it's off by default because they don't know if you have the bandwidth or the need for that. So Nextcloud, it's pretty cool stuff. Yes.
So how do you back it up?
What's that?
How do you back it up?
Oh, well, I personally, and for some reason, every time I try and open the page here, I get nothing. But I manage my system with VirtualMin, which is the next generation of WebMin and UserMin. It's a web interface that gives you point and clickiness to a Linux system. So instead of you typing a command line, you got an icon that says something, and you click that, and it asks you a question, you answer it, and it runs the Linux command for you. So that's kind of my style. But that has an easy backup system for me. So I would back up my subserver, virtual subserver, with that system instead of backing it up with the Nextcloud itself. But I didn't even look to see if there was a backup built in.
So kind of like turning the door locks back on at Jurassic Park and just point the light. Linux system, and you know this.
Yeah, there should be a name for system administrators that don't like to type.